Good evening and welcome to MMTV with me, Helena Vesti.
And me, Oscar Lynch. Our top story tonight. As the fire on Saddleworth Moor rages on, members of the fire service and army are being pushed to their limits to keep surrounding communities safe.
Plans have been approved for the creation of a 1,000-mile network of safe walking and cycling routes in Greater Manchester. We speak to Mayor Andy Burnham about the Beelines plan.
And England expects, but will Colombia crash the party? Fans of both countries look ahead to tonight's World Cup showdown. And we meet the UK team who is already celebrating a World Cup win.
But first, Saddleworth Moor, just north of Manchester, has been engulfed in flames for the past 9 days, stretching the region's resources. With no sign of the blaze slowing down, the endurance of responders from the fire service and army is being tested 24 hours a day. MMTV reporter Charlie Smith has the story.
As you can see here on Saddleworth Moor, the fire is still going and it doesn't show signs of letting up anytime soon. Hundreds of emergency services are still working away on this effort and are battling away in the heat constantly.
I spoke to those dealing with one of the largest wildfires in Manchester's living memory.
We've got a rotating shift of 30 soldiers providing support to the fire and rescue service for as long as they need it on a daily basis. It's not safe to put fires out when it goes dark. So they'll stand down at last light tonight and then be on the hill again at 4 o'clock in the morning when it gets light again. You put it out and it lights again. So you've got to make sure that it's put out properly. And because you can be engulfed and surrounded with it, clearly you've got to work in teams and you've got to be vigilant. And they've got to make sure that they're very controlled and they don't take any risks.
We've got a combination of firefighter tactics in place at the minute. So we've got some helicopters who are actually dipping into the reservoir behind me. They're using buckets underneath, underslung under the helicopter to drop water on certain areas. We've got crews from the army and the fire service using what are called fire beaters to beat the soil. And then we've got some other firefighters with water backpacks actually spraying water onto the affected areas. So there's numerous tactics being deployed.
As the fire enters its 10th day, the affected area has grown to almost a 4-mile radius.
We've got relief wagons behind us, canteen wagons. So we are rotating the crews on a regular basis. And we've had loads of support from Tesco's and different agencies that have come and actually provided water and supplies to us. And we've got our own Salvation Army who are charitable organisation which is providing supplies for us.
Providing support with water and food is the fire service's own Salvation Army.
We're doing basic food, corned beef, tuna, cheese sandwiches, hot dogs, chili dogs, tea, coffee, soup. Very basics, just to meet the physical needs of the firefighters, because in winter it's freezing, they need warm drinks. In summer like this they need cold drinks and lots of them to keep them fit. But it's just a case of giving the guys a chance to get away from the front line, come back, relax, have a cup of tea, bit of a laugh, bit of banter, and then when they go back into it, they're more ready to deal with it, they can get their heads around what's happening. And it eases the whole process of coming to terms with what can be a very difficult situation.
They've trained together and they work together, work well together. Yeah. And so the banter's good, the troops like this sort of stuff, and we train for it. It's not our primary role, but when we call up and do it, we do it really well.
I mean, collaboration between organisations is always great. I mean, we've got GMP looking after the road for us, trying to use it into one-way system. We've got several fire rescue services here. We've got Greater Manchester, Cheshire, Lancashire. We've got Derbyshire working on separate incidents over and away. We've got MWAS, the heart team here to support us. And we've actually got local farmers and landowners with their own sort of water bowsers who are also mucking in, as well as the armed forces. So yeah, there's been a real collaboration approach to the incident.
This is real life. This is dealing with people with a situation. And it's working with some of the best men and women I've ever come across. You know, people who literally, the old adage is when something catches fire, people run away from it. They run towards it. And you've got to be special. And believe you me, the guys who've been working up here, including the military, they're special people.
Between the Winter Hill and Saddleworth Moor fires, over 2,000 hectares of moorland has now been destroyed. And crews really are working at full capacity. Charlie Smith, Saddleworth Moor, Manchester.
Ambitious plans unveiled last week by Transport for Greater Manchester will aim to create the UK's most comprehensive cycling and walking network. The £500 million Beeline scheme, named in honour of Manchester's symbolic worker bee, will feature Dutch-style segregated cycling lanes and 1,400 new road crossings. Here's reporter Joseph Timmon with more.
The Mayor of Greater Manchester, Andy Burnham, joined the Salford City Mayor this morning to unveil new plans for a cycling and walking network around Greater Manchester.
The Beelines network will be the biggest of its kind in the UK. So we asked Andy Burnham whether this is his biggest project since he became Mayor of Greater Manchester last year.
In terms of its significance in all 10 of our boroughs, yes. And you know, it's not me who's been sitting down with the maps. You know, Chris Boardman and his team have done an amazing job. Yeah, this is a significant plan. I've committed more resource to this than anything else yet. So this has got a lot of money behind it.
Well, the idea came about because we need to stop using cars, or to be more to the point, we need to enable people to not have to use cars, because that's what it feels like right now. In Greater Manchester, we've got 250 million journeys a year in a car of less than a kilometre. So the potential here is absolutely massive. Walking's the easiest thing for people, but it's the segregation and the points where they hit busy roads that's a problem. Crossings are quite quick to do, they're quite cheap to do, and we can do them really fast. So we could have that part, a big chunk of it, in less than 2 years, which is pretty exciting.
Initially, there'll only be £160 million invested into this, but in the long run, there'll be a £1.5 billion investment into the cycling and walking network.
So the money comes from something called the Transforming Cities Fund. We received £243 million from the government in the budget. And we were asked to use that to do something to change the way the city works. So I have used part of that funding to buy 27 extra trams, because people who use the Metrolink system will tell you that obviously overcrowding is becoming a bigger and bigger problem. But it was my decision, supported by the 10 leaders of Greater Manchester, to then say, well, beyond that, we need to do something that really will change the way we work. And what else could I do that could touch every borough and every person in that borough in a very local way?
My team hasn't touched a pen. Every district has designed their own network using local knowledge. We've just asked questions, so tell me where you couldn't ride a bike now. Show me where you wouldn't want to walk with a double buggy with kids. And that's all been mapped out, right? Show me where you would get across those busy roads. This is where we would do it. And within hours, each district had built their own network, brought them all together, and it builds up to over 1,000 miles of usable roads and segregated lanes, all of them where local people have said that they're needed.
I think over the years we've not done this properly in Greater Manchester. You know, it's been very patchy, bit of a kind of a piecemeal approach. A few white lines on the road here, maybe a segregated path there, but it's never quite joined up together. The point about this is a new concept that we're asking everyone to buy into, GM standard for cycling and walking provision, so that wherever people go across Greater Manchester, they will then begin to expect facilities of a certain standard. And I think that's kind of recognising that our approach in the past hasn't worked particularly well, and it's time now to do something radically different.
The proposal includes 75 miles of Dutch-style segregated cycle lanes, like this one on Oxford Road, which stretches from the city centre to the student hubs of Fallowfield and Withington.
So what do cyclists and drivers using this route think of the new plans?
I think there are a lot of people who want to cycle, but sometimes in winter, for example, it's very dangerous.
It's just the buses being late. It's just, I don't know, they're pretty inconsiderate.
I'm all for community and helping the community and helping to stop people riding on footpaths. What we've got here is ideal, but get the roads marked up properly so that drivers know that they're not going into an area or straying into an area that they should be in.
Members of the public can view the Beelines map online, where they'll be able to leave comments as part of a consultation process.
I do see this as part of what I want to create as mayor. You know, a place where people can cycle and walk naturally without breathing in illegal polluted air, where they can have better health, save money in the process. It will just make this place a better place to live.
For now, the plans are in first gear. But there's a long road ahead before these ambitious proposals become more than just talk. Joseph Timmon, Oxford Road, Manchester.
Hundreds of people have signed a petition on Manchester Council's website calling for legal buffer zones to be implemented outside abortion-providing clinics after claims of intimidation and harassment of those seeking healthcare. Laura Fitzpatrick visited the Marie Stopes Clinic to learn more.
They have been known to do kind of a bit weirder stuff. So the first day that we ever got there to stand outside the abortion clinic to support the women going in, we saw a woman throwing holy water over the steps going up to the clinic, over the walls of the clinic. We've seen them try to hit one of us with their car. They hand out leaflets to women going into the clinic, which say things like ask to see the scan, which is obviously really, really upsetting for someone who's going in for an abortion.
I'm following the vote in Ealing to get a buffer zone put in place. It shows that like it is possible and we can do it. And I think that if we had a buffer zone, even if it was just at the end of the road, I mean, I think ideally we would need to go farther because they could still stand there, but it would remove them from directly outside the clinic, which I think is...
And Laura joins us now. What more can you tell us?
Well, hundreds of people have signed an online petition on the council's website calling for buffer zones outside abortion clinics in Manchester, because at current there's quite a regular pro-life presence outside the clinic in Fallowfield.
What are the council doing about the issue?
Well, back in January, the council passed a motion looking to introduce a similar thing, so it would be a 100 metre zone around the clinic where no one would be able to stand, not even the pro-choice campaigners. And basically, they want to introduce it as a public space protection order. What this means is they'll need to open it up to public consultation in order to work out whether really putting this in place would make a difference and whether it would be the most effective thing. So with this in mind, it's probably going to be in the coming months they'll be opening it up to the public to give their thoughts.
Now, what exactly is the procedure for obtaining a public space protection order?
So with the formalities of the public space protection order, as I said, it's to do with a public consultation, which is different to the petition that's currently ongoing. But with this in mind as well, in Ealing, where they've passed the first of its kind, the buffer zone, they have been challenged in the High Court, saying that it might be a restriction on human rights to stop people campaigning. So with this in mind, it seems the council might be holding back to wait to see what the outcome is on that before they go full steam ahead on introducing the zone.
Thank you, Laura. Now, historic Northern Quarter music venue Band on the Wall is celebrating after receiving a grant of over £1.5 million from Arts Council England. The grant will fund an expansion to increase the venue's capacity and allow it to create a smaller second space to host upcoming and emerging talent. Here's Charlie Smith with the story.
This week in Manchester, historic venue Band on the Wall has received £1.65 million of funding from Arts Council England.
The funding will be put towards Band on the Wall's expansion plans, which include upping the capacity of the venue from 350 to 500, as well as renovating the derelict Cocosa building at the rear of the site. A Certain Ratio's Martin Moscroft tells us more about the venue he first played over 40 years ago.
Well, Band on the Wall's been open since my dad was my age. He told me that he used to come to Band on the Wall, you know, around sort of the Second World War time. And he used to come when the band was on the wall, like you can see in the picture where the little three-piece band was up in the wall, which is why it's called Band on the Wall. So it's been about for a long time. It's been about a lot longer than any other venue in Manchester. For us, Band on the Wall was a really important venue to like sort of start off. Back then it was rough and ready. I mean, since they got their last funding, they got a really good sound system, really good lights, made it a lot plusher. Venues have been finding it pretty hard to survive. So Band on the Wall are like the kings of funding, really. They've always sort of been an Arts Council funded venue. We're in slap bang in the middle of the Northern Quarter here at Band on the Wall. But with Band on the Wall, people travel from all over to come here.
But despite Band on the Wall's funding, not all UK venues are treated equally. In some countries, like France, venues receive tax breaks and artists receive state-funded living expenses.
I think in Europe they treat it as a proper job, whereas in the UK it's still treated like it's some sort of art form or something that you don't really need paying for, or you've got to support with another job. If you go to Europe, you get you and play a gig, you get a really nice dressing room, you get really well looked after, you get really nice food cooked for you by a cook at the venue. You come to anywhere in the UK and do a gig, they dump you in a little shithole of a box with a dressing room that's filthy and not big enough to swing a cat in. They give you £10 each to go and get a buyout from the Chippy or McDonald's. And it's a totally, totally different way of doing things.
Although it is one of Manchester's oldest venues, Band on the Wall continues to hit all the right notes. Charlie Smith, Band on the Wall, Manchester.
Now, although this month is Plastic Free July, a popular Manchester restaurant has been helping diners be more environmentally friendly for years. Bundobust on Piccadilly uses plant-based products to serve its traditional Indian food, while all cutlery, crockery and straws are also 100% biodegradable. Here's Amelia Bruce-Watt with more.
In March of this year, Andy Burnham and Gary Neville launched the first citywide plan to drive down the use of single-use plastics in a bid to make Manchester plastic-free by 2020. Today, I'm outside Bundobust to talk to the manager of one of Manchester's small businesses making an effort to achieve this goal.
Bundobust is one of Manchester's small businesses leading the way, using sustainable packaging and reusable cutlery and plates. They originally started as a street food pop-up before setting up restaurants in Manchester and Leeds, and have been dedicated to making ethical choices ever since.
I think that there's kind of more of a backlash if you don't, and you need to respond to what customers are coming in and saying. Maybe you should use metal straws, which is a bit maybe too expensive. But biodegradable straws, they're not really that much more expensive. And we used to put straws in every single soft drink and two straws in every cocktail. So we stopped putting straws in every soft drink and just put like straws on the side of the bar. So if people want them, they can. Because even though they are biodegradable, doesn't mean it's not an excuse just to put everything in a straw in the drink and then like throw it away. Like you still need to try and not use them.
Bundobust believe that we now rely on the chains to make a conscious effort to use sustainable products if the city is going to achieve the mayor's goal in just 2 years' time.
I think it's definitely a good thing to try and push awareness for, and although some places can't use everything that's like biodegradable, but if you look at like one of the biggest chains in the country, Spoons, Wetherspoons, they've just stopped using plastic, and I think it's, although small independent businesses, we're probably more likely to stop using it. It's kind of, we need to rely on the people that are higher up, like people like McDonald's and stuff like that, Starbucks. Like, it's not hard to make a conscious decision to just 1 week order plastic straws, the next week order biodegradable. Like, it's really not that hard. I think we need to be looking at people like that to change and influence everyone.
Since the pledge was launched, many of the city's leading businesses and hospitality have set out plans to be plastic-free by 2020, and as a first step, have already replaced plastic straws with recyclable alternatives. The city is making progress, and with the launch of Plastic Free July campaign, companies all over Manchester are being encouraged to reduce their waste. Manchester United also unveiled their third kit earlier this year, which is made entirely of ocean plastic. Amelia Bruce-Watt, Piccadilly, Manchester.
All of Manchester is wishing the residents of our local dog cafe lots of puppy love as it celebrates its first birthday. Our reporter Helen Parkinson had the enviable task of visiting the cafe to see what they had in store to make it a perfect day.
This Manchester cafe has some very special customers. The Beach Dog Cafe at Central Park Doggy Daycare in Withenshaw celebrated its first birthday in June. It's the city's first canine cafe and paradise for dog lovers. Both two- and four-legged visitors can enjoy a wide range of food and drink. And there's plenty of opportunity for doggy cuddles. Some of the cafe's dogs belong to the centre's owners, but others are from the daycare, so you'll see different dogs every time.
I'm Gemma,
I'm one of the supervisors here at Central Park. I love this job, because there's so many different dogs, different characters and different breeds that you get to meet on a daily basis. And the most important thing for me is the fact that we rescue. So we rescue dogs from Greece and give them another chance in life by getting them homes over here in the UK.
And Gemma's actually rescued a rescue dog. She's adopted one of them, and I love having that one come back and all the other ones come back and play with us because we get them first and all that. My name is Laura. I'm originally from the States. Moved to Manchester 2 years ago. Since I live in a city flat, can't have a dog, and I just was really missing that because I love growing up with dogs and everything else. And so working here, that's been one of my favorite things, is because I travel so much, it's not fair for me to have one, and living in a flat, it's really not that ideal for the conditions. So I've been able to come to work and play with dogs every day and meet new dogs, all the regular ones are fun too.
It's great therapy.
It's a very good therapy, actually.
So dog lovers of Manchester, you know where to add to your to-visit list.
England are due to take on Colombia tonight in the second round of the World Cup, with kickoff less than an hour away. Oliver Dorney took to the streets to talk to natives from both nations about their team's chances.
I'm in Piccadilly Gardens today, ahead of England's last 16 clash with Colombia, a match Gareth Southgate has hailed as England's biggest in a decade. But who will win? Let's ask the fans.
2-1 after extra time, I reckon.
Who's going to score for England?
Well, Kane if the diver is there for him, but we get corners, Stones will probably knock in a couple.
And if we beat Colombia, do you think we have a realistic chance of winning the tournament?
I don't want to get too far ahead because the media storm's always like, we're going to win it this year. And it's ultimately disappointing. If we get to the semi-finals, which is realistic, I think we can be really proud as a nation of that achievement.
Who do you think
is
the danger man for the Colombian side?
Rodriguez, I think, is just sharp. He's got pace. He's got an eye for the game. He can pick out that pass. So, yeah, I think we keep him quiet and we should have a good chance.
And if we get to the final, who do you least want to face in the final?
Brazil or France. No, France. I think France, the way they played against Argentina, they were just absolutely terrifying. Mbappe, best player on the planet currently, and yeah, I think he'd tear us to shreds.
Well, I think, and I hope, it's going to be like 2-1 to Colombia, 1 England.
Who do you think's your most important player for Colombia?
Well, for me, I think every player is good, but if we're going to put in order, it's going to be like James Rodriguez, Falcao and Cuadrado.
3-1, England, in favour of England.
Who's scoring the goals?
Harry Kane, who scored twice, and probably Rashford on target once.
And if we win, do you think we've got a good chance of getting to the final?
Yeah, definitely.
Who do you think the danger men are for Colombia?
James Rodriguez, but probably, I hope, he's not fit to play. If he doesn't play, England have a good chance to go through.
And who do you think is our biggest danger? Which opponent would be the hardest if we get through?
Brazil. Definitely Brazil.
I'll give them a chance. I reckon 2-1. 2-1.
Who do you think the biggest danger for Colombia is?
The biggest danger? Combination of Kane and Stone, definitely.
Who do you think is the opponent England least want to face if we get through?
Oh, it's got to be Brazil. Yeah, Brazil. I was going to say France, definitely Brazil.
And what are you going to do if we win it?
When we win it. I'm going to spend the entire week on the other side of this bar.
England face Colombia tonight in Moscow at 7 p.m. Oliver Dorney, Piccadilly Gardens, Manchester.
And Gareth Southgate's men will be looking to emulate the spinning success of Great Britain's national table football team. Oliver also went along to meet the new foosball world champions.
The FIFA World Cup hasn't come home yet, but one thing has, and that's foosball. Last week, Team GB won the International World Series. I visited the Rainbow Snooker Club in Whitworth for more.
Well done, lads. So, how did the tournament go?
It was very difficult, actually. It was one of the toughest tournaments we've ever played in at the European Cup. We were there last year, came third, and we didn't think we were going to improve much on that this year. But as it happens, we did.
I've seen you wearing a glove.
Yeah.
Is that really necessary in this game?
It is. It's to improve the grip of the bar and on the table. It's just so that the ball feels a bit more secure under the player. It helps to... During the game, we actually sweat a lot, and the glove helps to increase grip. And
talk us through your road to the finals, Phil, that you've taken at home.
Well, when we scored the winning goal, I sobbed. I sobbed. Just walked away and sobbed, you know. Big kid, really.
Sobbed with emotion?
Oh, most definitely. It was thoughtful for over four solid days.
There was surreal. When we won, we were looking at the referee and he says, we actually won.
Thanks for that, Oliver, and well done to the lads, and fingers crossed for England tonight.
Thank you for watching, and good evening, Manchester.
Good evening.